Welcome back. You're listening to Get Real. I'm your host, Bob Gallagher. Joining me in the studio today is a very special guest and personal friend, Hong Tran of Lee Hong Attorneys at Law. Welcome to the show, Hong. How are you doing?
Good. Thank you so much for having me on.
Well, we appreciate you coming. We've been asking you for quite a while to join us in the studio for a segment, and we finally managed to wrangle you, only with the promise of lunch, but still, you came in, and that's important to us. We appreciate it.
I'm afraid of the mic.
Yeah, I'm sure. So we asked you on to the show today to kind of talk about the real estate transaction from the attorney's perspective, you know, because a lot of our listeners and a lot of first-time buyers out there listening, they assume you involve an attorney in something, and it's a big, it must be a big issue or a big deal, and it kind of scares them off a little bit. So we kind of wanted to let you kind of walk us through what a transaction is like and what you do. And I've got a few questions here for you. You know, just a general question. You know, how do you help as an attorney, a real estate attorney? How do you help buyers and sellers through the process?
Well, it's a long process,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah,
and from the very beginning, let's take the buyers from the buyer's perspective,
yeah.
what we do for them and what happens before it comes to us.
Right.
So the buyer has to go get a pre-qualification, pre-approval letter to know that they qualify
right.
in some form or manner in order to purchase. Then
right.
they would hire one of the awesome real estate agents to take them around to see properties that fit their requirements or
right.
qualifications.
Right.
And then from there, they would make an offer. Offer gets accepted.
Mm-hmm.
Then the home inspection. Home inspection gets negotiated.
Mm-hmm.
After all that is done, it gets to the attorneys.
Right.
So here in Massachusetts, it's usually the seller's attorneys that draft the purchase and sales. But obviously, when a seller's attorney drafts the purchase and sales, it protects the sellers.
Right, right.
So when it comes to us, we add riders, we add language on there to protect our buyers as well.
Hmm.
And when we add language on there, we want to make sure that everything that is negotiated between the buyers and the sellers through mm-hmm. the brokers get onto the purchase and sales, because sometimes you don't know what has been negotiated or what has happened.
That's true.
In the time that before it got to you. And sometimes you just get a blast of emails where if you don't read the emails correctly, if you don't go down all the way through the chains, you're not going to know what has been fully
right.
negotiated.
So it's all about the details.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's very detailed oriented once
right.
it gets to our section.
Right.
And then right after the back and forth with the seller's attorney and the purchase sales gets approved,
mm-hmm.
we would either call the client or meet up with the client to review the purchase sales, because it's the last approval and the last say in this is the buyer, and they want
mm-hmm.
we want to make sure that everything is all included in there.
Right.
So when we review this with the buyer the last time, if the buyer catches anything that's not on there or there's a mistake in it, then
mm-hmm.
we would have to go back to the seller's attorney and make these changes.
Right.
So once all that is done, that's when that's when we're comfortable for the buyers to sign the purchase sales.
Right.
And sometimes buyers are they don't have the time to come to our office, so
mm-hmm.
we would utilize one of our partner real estate agents who can put this through DocLoop, DocuSign, or any of these electronic signature systems that they utilize
mm-hmm.
to have our clients sign. Now, when our clients are signing this, they know the version that we have
mm-hmm.
reviewed with them and finalized, and from there, they would make their additional deposit.
Excellent.
Yep.
And speaking of deposits, who holds the deposit once the purchase and sales is signed?
Well, usually the deposit is held by the seller side, because
mm-hmm.
if the buyer is putting down deposit, I mean, it becomes useless for the buyer's side or the buyer's agent or the buyer's attorney to be holding the deposit, right?
Right.
So it's usually the seller side. So some attorneys would hold the deposit.
Mm-hmm.
Some listing brokers would hold the deposit.
Right.
Yeah. But I normally like it when the listing agent holds the deposit for the purchase sales as well, because the listing agent is also holding deposit for the offer to purchase. So now
mm-hmm.
let's keep all the deposit in one escrow account.
Oh, that's smart.
Yeah.
Yeah, excellent. So one of the things that we talked about before we got started today was title insurance. And I get questions about this all the time on the mortgage side of things, and I'd love to have you kind of explain what title insurance is and what role it plays in the transaction.
Look, there are, let me explain what title insurance is, and I'll tell you the two types of title insurance, which is the owner's title insurance and the lender's title insurance.
Mm-hmm.
Title insurance protects you against anything that had happened to title prior to your ownership. Obviously, mm-hmm. you can't buy title insurance to protect you against the stuff that you do that makes the title defective.
Right.
So it protects you against any of the defective titles that's not listed in the exceptions.
Mm-hmm.
So as a closing attorney, prior to the closing, we search title.
Mm-hmm.
We would order a title search, and title search, and it keeps on going backwards. It starts from, let's say right now it's 2017, it goes to 2019, you search 2018, 17, 16, you keep on going backwards. Mm-hmm. But you can't indefinitely go backwards. When do you stop? Well, Massachusetts...
1,000 years.
Yeah. Well, Massachusetts says 50 years, 50.
Mm-hmm.
But the lender goes, hey, I'm loaning a lot of money. Mm-hmm. What if something happened 62, 75 years ago that's not caught when the land was all together before it was all subdivided? What if something happened to this title? Or what if something happened to title within those 50 years that was not caught on the title search?
Mm-hmm.
I, the lender, want to be protected. So that's why the lender makes the buyer buy lender's title insurance.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if the lender is doing that, why wouldn't the owner get owner's title insurance to protect the owner? Mm-hmm. As well. And when you buy owner and title insurance together, there's always that discount for the owner's title insurance. That's why the owner mm-hmm. would get a higher protection mm-hmm. than the lender would, but for less of an amount.
Right.
Yeah.
Excellent. Excellent. Now, have you ever had to deal with any title issues that come up after the fact, or is it usually relatively clean?
It's usually relatively clean if it's a normal purchase.
Right.
But if you're dealing with a property where there was a short sale prior, or it was an REO, REOs are foreclosed properties, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's usually issues in those things.
Right.
And some of the issues they're usually discharges.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say the previous seller owns the property, but they owe mortgage, and they owe real estate taxes, and they owe private lenders, or they owe contractors mm-hmm. where they would put in the materials liens on the property. And if some of these things were not discharged prior, and the owner and the seller has owner's title insurance,
mm-hmm.
we could have the title company go and do an undertaking, an indemnity undertaking for the current buyer. So that we can close the transaction. That only works if you have owner's title insurance, right? If you don't, then there's no one there to protect you.
Right.
And having owner's title insurance, the title insurance company, they have the obligation to defend mm-hmm. if it's not one of their list of exceptions. So let's say if someone comes up with a title claim, something's wrong with title.
Mm-hmm.
If you didn't have that title insurance, the owner would have to hire an attorney to defend that claim.
Right.
Because you have to defend it, right?
Right. Well,
or
what
else
about
you lose by default?
Right. What about people that are thinking, well, if I have lender's title insurance, why wouldn't that cover me?
That's because the lender's title insurance only protects the lender for the value of what the lender loaned them the amount of money for.
Right.
So let's say if there was that title defect, title issue,
mm-hmm.
and it ends up that the lender or the lender's title insurance company loses out on that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, guess what? Not only the lender losing on that amount of money, but the owner has lost all the equity in that house as well.
I see. So the loan amount would be protected with the lender's title insurance, but any equity you had in the property wouldn't be protected if you didn't have owner's title, correct?
Correct. But when you have owner's title insurance, not only does it protect you, not only does it pay out on the equity, it pays out to the full value of what you purchased the title insurance for. So wow. It's not just the equity.
Oh, wow.
Right?
Well, yeah, I guess that's the other thing. You know, I'm sure people are thinking, well, what if I bought a house with no money down? Why do I need it? But just because you have no equity in the house today doesn't mean 10 years from now you're not going to have a lot of equity in it, right?
Absolutely.
And it would protect you in that case too?
Correct.
Or does it only protect you? Does it protect you to the current value of the property or only up to what you paid for it?
It protects you up to what you pay for it.
Okay.
So it's just like any other insurance. Let's say you buy life insurance for $100,000. You passed away. Your
right.
family gets that $100,000, not how much you're worth, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And that's, and we're talking about a worst case scenario. We certainly don't want to scare people in the audience. Usually the stuff that you're talking about is not so much that you would lose your house or lose your equity, even though that's a possibility. It's not something that happens frequently. The bigger issue is that a claim is made against the property, and if you don't have owner's title insurance, you're the one that's going to have to pay to defend it in court, correct?
Correct.
And which could easily run $20,000, $30,000.
It depends on what kind of title it is, too.
Right.
Or what kind of title defect it is, too.
Right.
And these things don't come up until the current buyer starts to sell their property, because there's going to be another buyer's attorney or lender's attorney that is going to research the title and find these things and say, hey, it's defective.
Right. And we run into it occasionally, too, where the previous previous closing attorney or lender never recorded a discharge when a mortgage was paid off. And I would imagine that if there's an issue like that, title insurance would help out as well.
That's one of the biggest things, actually, because so on a closing, you would get the payoff and then you send the lender that amount of money. It usually takes them 30 days for them to send the discharge. Mm-hmm. Some payoffs include the discharge recording fees, where the lender would mail the fee and the discharge to the registry to record. Mm-hmm. Some discharges don't. So they could mail this to the closing attorney, or they could mail it to the owner. Mm-hmm. I've seen situations where the owner is holding the discharge, but they don't know what to do with it, because no one has ever told them that, hey, if you get this discharge, make sure you record it or bring it to us so we can record it.
Right.
And it never gets recorded. And now when the issue comes up, we have to go back and ask the title insurance company to do what's called the indemnity and undertaking. Indemnity is indemnifying the buyer and the buyer's title insurance company, and mm-hmm. undertaking is taking on the role to obtain this discharge from that previous lender so that you can record this.
And that is more common than people realize.
Absolutely.
Because, I mean, you're talking about a massive amount of paperwork that gets done on these deals. Even though a lot of it is electronic now, whenever you have people involved, mistakes can be made. And you're talking, I can't even take a guess at how many discharges are recorded in the course of a year in just the state of Massachusetts alone.
Correct.
Some percentage of those are going to get missed.
Right.
And what people don't realize, they're probably thinking, well, so you go back to the mortgage company, you have proof that you paid it off, shouldn't be that big of a deal. Yeah, but what happens when the company that you originally took the mortgage out from has been sold and acquired 19 other times and now no longer really exists other than a file cabinet in some warehouse somewhere?
I've seen that situation where company A gets bought out by company B and later on bought out by company C. Mm-hmm. And they do assignments of the note. Right? Mm-hmm. And so the owner of that mortgage would be, let's say, company C right now. Mm-hmm. But if company A goes and sends out a discharge, that's incorrectly discharged.
Right.
Or vice versa, if they never did the assignment of these mortgages because they're just buying each other out.
So it's basically worthless. You haven't accomplished anything. It's still not
binding
yet.
They attempted to do it, but they did it incorrectly. So that's a title defect.
Right.
And that's where the title insurance would come in, so that we can get the title company to go and fix that.
Right, because you don't want to be the owner of a home chasing down some bank that no longer exists to try and get somebody to give you what you need to get that recorded.
Correct.
I imagine you want somebody that's doing this as their profession to make sure it gets cleaned up.
Correct. Right. And I mean, if you don't know, you could be spending hours, weeks, and days.
A lot of time or a lot of money.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So at the end of the day, it's probably a smart choice to buy the title insurance.
It's always a smart choice, right?
Absolutely. So let's talk about the other things that you do to protect your buyers. You know, we were talking again a little bit before the show. There is a financing contingency in the purchase and sales, and there's, you know, the closing date. And those are the dates that we have to meet on the financing side. Tell us a little bit about why, even after a loan's been approved, you tend to extend the financing date. What's the purpose of that?
So some attorneys think I'm crazy for continuing to ask for extensions, even though after we got the mortgage commitment. Most of these mortgage commitments come in with conditions.
Yes.
Buyer, here's a mortgage commitment with conditions A, B, and C. Well, what if we can't satisfy one of those commitments and we never ask for an extension on the mortgage commitment? Mm-hmm. If one of those conditions are not satisfied, I don't want to risk losing my client's deposit. Mm-hmm. I mean, some of these deposits could be a lot of money. I mean, mm-hmm. $1,000, $5,000 to a transaction of $500,000 may not be a big percentage, but for a buyer, mm-hmm. with it being their first time buying a house, could right. be a lot of money. I mean, it's so we need to protect them.
Right.
And not until all of these conditions are satisfied,
right.
then I feel comfortable to not ask for further extensions.
Right. Which is smart. And you are smart to do it, because you actually did have somebody, I don't know how recently it was, but I know we were talking about this a while back, that lost their job after approval.
Correct. I mean, during the whole mortgage process, the lender would get documentations from human resource that the client is working. But
right.
a few days prior to the closing, the processor would continue to check. I mean, they do the VOE, right? The
right.
verification of employment, to make sure that the client is still working there.
Right.
I mean, what if the client has been laid off?
Right.
And that is one of the conditions.
And it has happened.
Yeah. Yeah.
So in this spot, your clients would be protected because the financing date was extended, and since they technically no longer meet the terms of the commitment, they would get the deposit back.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct.
So it's all about making sure your buyers are protected.
Correct. And the opposing counsel understands that sometimes they would ask us to qualify our extension, saying that only under these conditions, ABC, Hong, because we don't want any other surprises.
Right.
And that's fine. That's understandable.
Fair. Yeah. Yeah. Excellent. Excellent. So a couple more minutes. We're almost out of time. I can't believe it's already been so long. I want to make sure I get a couple of things in here, though. Your main office is located in Worcester, right?
Correct.
And you're a full-service real estate law firm. You do some other stuff as well, but primarily real estate law. Why don't you talk about the areas you cover? Because a lot of people are assuming if you're based in Worcester, that's probably what you cover. Why don't you elaborate on that for us?
Okay, so we also have an office in Randolph.
Right.
We're licensed to do closings in Mass, Connecticut, New Hampshire, and Rhode Island.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm always on the road doing closings. And
I was going to say that. Usually when I talk to you, you're either in a closing or about to go into a closing or in the car driving to a closing.
Yes.
So not only are you licensed there, you actually frequently do. You do a lot of closings in Connecticut and New Hampshire particularly too, right?
Correct.
Especially, and Rhode Island.
Yeah, Rhode Island. Especially with Rhode Island and Connecticut, it's different from here in Massachusetts. Massachusetts, we actually have a registry where we register all the recording lands. And in Rhode Island and Connecticut, it's actually done at the town halls. So normally we would do a real estate closing at the real estate offices, and we would walk the documents over to the town hall to record.
Right.
Yeah.
Which I was shocked at. I had no idea that Connecticut and Rhode Island didn't have those.
Yeah, they don't. It's all recorded and it's all kept at the town hall.
That must make it interesting. I also want to give out your contact info too. Why don't you share the phone number, the best phone number to reach you or
sure.
your company?
Maybe I should give up my wife's cell phone number. No, my company number is 508-799-4529, and that's 508-799-4LAW.
Excellent, excellent. And then I think that's it, unless you have any final tips you want to offer us about closing and how to be prepared. For the actual closing, I mean, I probably should have been a little more specific.
Yeah, well, for the actual closing, make sure that you bring IDs, mm-hmm. and also you bring either a bank check or you wire money into our accounts. And if you're going to be wiring money, make sure you're calling us to verify that it is our wiring instruction, because there has been a lot of wire fraud.
Oh, yeah, yes. that's a good point, too.
It's huge.
Yeah. Thank you. That's a lot of great information, Hong. Again, that was Hong Tran with Lee Hong, Attorneys at Law. We appreciate you coming on the show.
Awesome. Thank you so much for having me.
You're very welcome. We're going to take a quick break for commercials. We'll be back after this.